Hey folks, John Schneider here. There's a couple of things I just want for you to consider. And first and foremost, I have no vendetta against Mr. Baldwin. I have no issue with Mr. Baldwin. What I'm trying to do, and what for some reason is burning in my soul, is I want the opportunity for justice to work. That's all. And what does that mean? The folks who are investigating what happened out there can only investigate it to the degree which their area of expertise lies. What does that mean? That means there are certain protocols and certain habits and certain regulations, rules and regulations that happen on a movie set that are different than things that happen elsewhere. Just as there are rules and regulations in the back storage room of a department store, or in the back storage room, they are different from a department store, I'm quite certain, to a hardware store, to a farmer's market. There are different rules and regulations on a dirt track than there are on a dirt road, and therefore, there are different expectations. Okay, there are different expectations. So there are things that are required by OSHA, by SAG, by the DGA, by the Cinematographers Union, which I believe is ACE, I think. but there are rules and regulations that are in place specifically to keep working conditions a certain way, and to keep on the list are to keep the members of these respective unions safe. So there were things that were expected to be done that, while they are not laws per se that must absolutely be adhered to, there are expectations within those rules that people will meet them. So what I want to ask you to consider is the gentleman who, or crew members, I'm not sure how many people, even if it was one, who wrote a letter that expressed their concern for a number of issues in that list of issues was a mention of safety, specifically pointing out firearms on the set. Now the letter that I read in the interview that I saw was a part of the camera crew. It was someone who was part of the camera crew. So when you are part of the when you're an actor, everything's looking this way. When you're part of the camera crew, it's all that way. So you're over there, directly in the line of sight. You'll hear on a set, clear the eye lines, because if an actor is supposed to be looking off and longingly looking off at his future or his lost puppy or a tank or whatever that is supposed to be looking at, it'd be nice not to be looking right at a crew member who's maybe checking their messages on their phone when you're trying to act. Okay, so that's what clear the sightlines means. So it makes perfect sense that someone who is on that side of the camera would be someone who was aware of safety protocols that were being ignored. Perfect sense. Consider that this person wrote this letter and resigned, quit. Okay? So basically, they ensured that they were not going to be employed any longer, not only on this production, but in future productions that this company was doing. Because once you've written a letter and you've cited that, you know, these people are doing this, 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 and this, and it's unsafe and I'm leaving, you're basically, you're making sure that you're not going to work for the rest of the year, especially if you do that in November, right? And my understanding is that this company was actually, immediately after this film was to be done, they were going to be moving on to do another film. That's important. So, and this is also important. When that letter was written and when that crew member left under their own power, they were saying that their safety is more important than their employment. And this is the most important thing. They said that before anyone was killed. They didn't say it after. They said it before. They left that morning. So then a month and change later, a letter comes out written by crew members. And I read that as well. And that letter is very carefully worded to protect those who remained employed. Again, that's an important distinction. The one person or the people who wrote a letter and removed themselves from harm's way, and a letter that was written by folks who were actually ensuring their future employment. Okay, I think it's important to think about that. I think it's important for a judge and for a jury to think about that. I find it difficult to believe that, I think there were 25 people on that letter. And I don't know if they signed them or their names were just mentioned, I'm not sure what. But 25 is an interesting number because that gives you the opportunity to be able to say dozens. It was 25, it was two dozen plus one. So that letter was written after the fact, and in that letter they accused the folk who wrote the first letter of saying things that were patently untrue. Well, they were citing safety issues and felt that they were unsafe, specifically regarding firearms on that set, and they left, and then someone was killed by a firearm on that set. So I don't think that you can claim that their claims were patently false, is I think the word they use, patently false. Apparently, they were not. If they were patently false, we wouldn't be having this conversation. So, my question then becomes, was it specifically Mr. Baldwin that the first letter was citing, or was it, you know, was it him who never checked a weapon, right? He was handed a weapon, pardon me, he was handed a weapon like this, and he never did that. That's all it takes, okay? You're handed a weapon. When I borrowed this for this, when I borrowed this weapon last night, the man that handed it to me did this. He said, "This is a Colt 45. I said, "Wow, that's a beautiful gun." He handed it to me, and I went, "My gosh, whose is this? Is this yours, or did you have to borrow it?" It's habitual for anyone who knows anything about a firearm. However, if if Mr. Baldwin was ever seen on the set not checking the weapon, there are, I don't know if there are 40 or 50 people on the set, there's probably 40, it's a $6 million movie, maybe there was less, maybe there were 30, but it's hard to believe that 30 people would watch over the course of a couple of weeks an actor be handed a weapon and never seeing him check it, not call attention to that. It's very difficult to believe that the assistant director would witness that, because many times he would be, I suppose, and this doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me, but the reports are that he would hand it to Mr. Baldwin. And he never checked it. So if he never checked it, why didn't safety procedures be more adhered to? Okay? If you have a bunch of people who are on that side of the camera, who are definitely in harm's way should something horrific happen, should a live round wind up in a weapon, it's in all of their best interest to pay attention to what's going on. All of them. But that didn't happen. Now, if Mr. Baldwin was ever witnessed, and a lot of people take pictures on the set, there is a set photographer, which brings up another question. Was the set photographer in that church when a weapon like this was fired and someone was killed? Are there photographs of what we hear is this, right? There's only one way. Now here, I don't want to get up down that rabbit trail. So if he never checked the weapon throughout the course of the movie, I believe someone would call attention to that. Especially the armorer, actually, especially the first, pardon me, I'm hoarse, especially the first AD. Because the first AD would have said something like, well, you know, Alec never checks the weapon, so I'm going to have to check it twice. Common sense. Since he is never going to check the weapon, I need to check it twice. And yet, we are told that the first AD didn't check it either. Now, if Mr. Baldwin was witnessed checking his weapon ever, then you have to ask the question, why didn't he that time? These are questions I believe should be brought to the light of day in a court of law. They shouldn't be discussed just like this. Something went terribly, terribly wrong. Someone is dead. Someone was shot, which brings up another point. Someone who knows what happened there has yet to be asked any questions, but I'm sure will, because they were there. That's the director, okay? The director has answers to probably all of these questions. But my fear is that if this is allowed to be pushed over to the side as a tragic accident and not negligence, then these questions will never be asked. These questions then will never be answered, and Helena's family will never have any kind of closure of any kind. And they will then blame protocol, as I'm already seeing them do. We need more strict rules. We need more strict regulations. We need all this. We need. We need to build more protection into this. No, we need to stick to the protocols we already have. As 99.99999% of people who have ever handled a firearm on a movie set have done since the first movie, which, by the way, there was the kiss, there was the racehorse, the thoroughbred, and there was also a gunshot, boom, that scared people because a man with a big mustache fired a gun into the camera. It was a blank. So these are questions I feel must see the light of day. That's why I'm harping on this. Finally, it's a very small building. I'm going to show you. I'm going to cut away and show you another part of why I feel that the truth is not being told accurately. When you check a weapon like this, I mean, remember, when you have a weapon like this, hold please. Well, when you have a weapon like this, you can actually see this little spot here? Yeah, you can see my computer screen right through that spot. When it is loaded, you can see brass in here. You can tell how many are there. It's how you can tell where the bullet is. Many people will keep the hammer on an empty chamber, in case they drop it and in case something terrible happens, where you could actually drop this gun on a bullet, and I do not believe that it would go off. I mean, you'd have to. I don't know what you'd have to do in order to have that happen, because there's inertia involved. And so anyway, there's also, when you have one of these kinds of weapons, and again, I'm going to show you, it is in fact, there you go, this is what I'm looking at when I'm, okay, see? So there's another school of thought where when you are pointing a gun, see right here? This is where, if it were loaded, you would see that in there, okay? In the barrel, you would see the lead from the from the bullet in there. Now, I've pointed guns like this toward cameras many, many times. And they will put dummy bullets. You've heard about dummy bullets. They'll put dummy bullets in there so that it appears to be loaded. Otherwise, you can put that in there with CGI, but it's a pain and it's cost prohibitive. So why do that? So that's why you would have dummy bullets on the set. But with a weapon like this, and apparently he was to cross-draw it and then pull the hammer back, and then fire it. Now, what we're hearing is that his finger was not on the trigger, and he was pulling it back and saying, here, and if you let it go here, look what happens, okay? If you let it go all the way back here, look what happens. If you go past this click, look what happens. Nothing. Nothing. So unless you already had your finger on the trigger, and now if I have my finger on the trigger and I pull it back and I let it go, look, it's going to go all the way. I'm not going to do that again because that's dry firing a weapon, and I don't want to do that to this man's gun. So that's a question I think needs to be examined. Is it possible that that particular gun had been altered in such a way to make it so you could pull the hammer back and have it not engage there? And yes, of course it is. But if that were the case, that would be the first thing someone would say. Whoa, hang on a second. That's a different kind of gun. It's specific to the story. It was designed specifically to be able to be fanned without having your finger on the trigger. Then that's a whole different story. But that brings up another question. The other question is, or an observation rather, when I've done a film where a firearm is required of me, and I am one of the leads in the movie, a very specific firearm is is assigned to me. Okay? And we've already talked about when a cup of coffee is handed to an actor, that cup of coffee becomes a prop and it becomes the responsibility of the prop man or woman, they call them the prop master or the prop mistress, to keep their eyes on this, to know where it is at all times, so that when you're ready to do a shot somewhere and an actor says, hey, where's my, I need my gun, and the prop guy can't say, I don't know where it is. So they are in charge of that weapon, and that weapon is, for the for the extent of the film, assigned to that actor. So whatever gun this was, it was Alec Baldwin's gun in the movie. Which means that because not only was it an actor's gun, it was the actor's gun, which means it was kept up with, should have been kept up with very well. I've never seen a situation where a lead actor's weapon was allowed to just sit on a table somewhere. Because, you know, there are people who might think, ooh, this would be a great souvenir. So not for safety, just for so that the prop man doesn't wind up looking like an idiot because they can't find Mr. Baldwin's gun, or Mr. Schneider's gun, or Mr. whoever's gun. So that speaks of a gun that is more well tended to than other guns in the box. Are you following that? Okay. Lastly, and this time I mean it, I'm going to show you this. If you take this weapon and you are in we're going to do this outside, I would never fire this weapon inside because it would probably deafen me for an hour. I'd at least have my ears ringing. If you fired this gun in that building, everyone in there, if it had a live round in it, would have known immediately, because the sound that comes out of this gun will hurt you. And the recoil, Westerns are not this. You don't do that in Westerns. You shoot like this, you know. The recoil from this weapon is what I want to show you. See that? Well, but see, the habit is anytime you do anything where your attention, even if you're holding it, if you're holding the gun and your attention is taken off of the gun before you stick it in your waistband, you check it. Is that the law? Will someone arrest you if you don't? No, that's not the law, but that is the habit of anyone who's, I believe, anyone who's used firearms on a set. That is a habit. Somebody says, here's a gun, John. They go like this, they say it's empty, right? They hand it to you, you then take it and go, okay, let me check. Yes, empty weapon, right? And then you put it in your belt or your holster. In this case, we are told that
Alec was cross drawing. Okay, now this holster does not fit me, but that means this, right? That's what that means. We hear all kinds of terms and we don't know what they mean, right? Crossfiring, what is that? What does that mean? This is like gun smoke, boom. This is crossfiring, all right? So I'm going to load this gun. I have let it out of my sight for a moment, so I'm going to check it. And now I'm going to take a bullet. Boy, they're really in there. I'm going to get out of it. This is a bullet. I'm going to take this belt off because it's way too big for me. And I am going to load it. Now, when you load a firearm, it's an intentional action. You can't put this gun in a box with a bunch of live rounds and shake it and expect a live round to go in there, because check this out. You can't move the cylinder unless you are there. Then you can move the cylinder. And you can see how easy it is to check. I mean, you've seen it in 100 Westerns where somebody will load a gun, then they'll go like that. There. Okay. This weapon is now hot. I'm going to put the live round right there so that I know the next time I pull the trigger, it will fall on an empty chamber. I'm going to go right now and get my glasses because I don't know. I'm not shooting anything, I'm shooting into the grass. But the point of this exercise is to exhibit to you the recoil of a 45 Colt, okay? So, imagine we're inside a small building. The gun is crossfired, cocked, and fired. My ears are ringing. Are your ears ringing? Okay. Look how far away he is. He's way over there. His ears are ringing. Immediately after that happens, they say, cut. Or if I'm supposed to put the gun back and then run away, they'll say, cut. The armorer or the prop man will come up. You will hand them the weapon. They will remove the brass, check the weapon again, and then depending on what's happening next, either they will take it and put it back in the box, or they will give it to you and you will put it back in your holster. Okay? That's a loud noise. That's a lot of fire. I find it difficult to believe that the person that was holding this weapon didn't know that something terrible had just happened. I would like for that to be considered in a court of law, not just a court of public opinion.
So I ask you, with that kind of sound and that kind of recoil in that size of a building, how is it possible that anyone, let alone the person that felt the recoil, whose finger, by the way, is reportedly not on the trigger. I believe this gun would have flown out of his hands and surprised the hell out of him. I don't think you can hold on to this weapon if it were fired accidentally without having your finger in there, because this is a grip. This is not. So how is it that he didn't know something terrible had happened? I just find that so hard to believe. Because he wouldn't have been wearing ear protection if they were actually doing a shot with a blank in that room. The first AD would have said, all right, gun's gonna be hot in this, which means it's a blank, not a bullet. Gun's gonna be hot in this. Would anyone like ear protection? Wear your ear protection if you have it. All right, we're gonna go. Are you ready? All right. So make the gun go hot. Armorer comes over, puts a blank in the gun, turns it so that the next shot will put the hammer on the back and be able to fire the blank. This comes back, the trigger is pulled, I'm not going to do it, and smoke comes out and everybody's fine. It's still very, very loud. But none of that happened because it was a rehearsal. There was no reason for anyone in that room to be wearing ear protection at that point, because all they were doing was lining up a shot, right? That's all they were doing. If this gun went off in that room, everybody in there would have gone, "Pow!" Including the person who did or did not pull the trigger. So these are questions I think deserve answers for the family and for the future of a business that I love and for the future of a genre that I love. I love Westerns. I don't want to see Westerns become the bad guy in this scenario. That's why I'm continuing to do this. Okay? Now, when it goes to court, I'll shut up. If it doesn't go to court, I just can't. I can't. I think we owe it to those who are in that building and those who are affected by the loss of she who was in that building. Helena's family and our industry deserve to be able to ask questions. Because as far as I'm concerned, not a whole lot of this is adding up. I'm John Schneider. Hope you're doing well. Have a merry, merry Christmas. And I'll see you down the road.